Hello everyone, we're here with Amy Salmon and we are live. We'll be live today. We'll be talking about health coaching and springtime goodness. Today is the first full day of spring, so we're going to try to give as many tips as possible regarding how to transition into a new season. But let me pass it over to Amy and have her introduce herself.
Hi everyone, happy spring. I am Amy Salmon. I'm the founder of The Wellness Map. Just to let you know a bit about myself briefly, I was suffering with chronic illness for over 30 years and kept medicated unnecessarily by my doctors. And after changing my diet and lifestyle, today I live symptom-free from all signs of illness and unnecessary medications. So I'm thrilled to be here with you today, James, and talking to you all today as well.
That's great, right? Like when we have our own personal experiences of what's worked for us in changing diet, lifestyle, and to see the changes in ourselves. And then it's almost like we're our own guinea pig of what worked and what didn't. And then we get to share that goodness with other people. And whether that's just through health counseling or your specific challenges that you overcame, or just having an understanding of how to connect with somebody and asking them questions about their personal lives, in order for them to dive deeper and find out what could be the connections that happen for them and the conditions that they might have.
Absolutely.
So with you, can you talk a little specifically about what your condition was and what drove you to change that?
Sure. Well, my journey started at a very young age. I mean, I was just 10 years old. My mother suddenly passed away, and at 12 years old, I started getting really sick, so I was suffering with debilitating stomach pains and digestive disorders, and I was having these very painful attacks on a very regular basis that were lasting 4 hours at a time. So this just became a very regular way of being for me, and I thought it was something I would have to tolerate. Now after college, the attacks increased up to 3 times a day, and when I went to see doctors, I was put through a series of tests and elimination diets, and they gave me a diagnosis of IBS, which is irritable bowel syndrome. That's a stress-related disorder, and gave me medications and sent me on my way. So when I moved into the city around that time, the attacks continued. Saw more doctors, got more medication, and didn't have any symptom relief. So I was suffering with a whole host of other health issues, and every time I went to the doctor, I got a new medication. So now I had a whole cocktail of medications that were just masking my symptoms. And eventually I was diagnosed with Hashimoto's disease, which is an autoimmune disorder that attacks the thyroid. So I was suffering with extreme brain fogginess, swelling in the face, muscle aches and pains, belly distension, and extreme fatigue. And I was kind of excited to get the diagnosis because I thought for sure that medication would help me at that time, and it didn't relieve any of my symptoms. So after speaking to my doctor about changing my diet, he said there was no need to change my diet because food had nothing to do with it. So I really questioned that and started bouncing around from doctor to doctor trying to get answers to these crazy, unmanageable symptoms I was having, and no one had any answers. It was, I don't know. So I was like, wow, a lot of fancy degrees, a lot of titles, a lot of letters next to names, but no answers. So ultimately, after a lot of frustration and emotional distress, as you can imagine, I took my health into my own hands, and after drastically changing the way I was eating and living, my symptoms began to lift immediately, and after a few months I weaned myself off all these unnecessary medications, and then I decided I really wanted to go help others change their lives and get healthy naturally.
Yeah, a different approach.
Absolutely.
And it's funny because I'm a health counselor as well, so even when you say things like Hashimoto's and elimination diet,
right?
No, I know what you're talking about.
Right.
But right, there was once a time when you and I, like when we did see doctors or those things were told to us, it's like, what are you talking about?
Yes.
So it's great to have the knowledge base now that we have, but it's also, it's not just about the knowledge, or it's not just about, or you mentioned medication. You didn't even mention any of the names of the medications, right? When you add all that in, it's, for many people, it's a lot of information thrown their way, and you kind of can't see the forest from the trees. It's just like, what's going on here? And oftentimes, the person that's giving you that information doesn't really know where you are either. They just know a little bit more than you in terms of the information. But it's like, what's the approach going to be with that? And so like something like an elimination diet is just as simple as taking a food out of your diet to see if you have any, if it has any effect on you, or if something changes in you due to no longer eating that food. Correct. But any of us can do that on our own. And honestly, I think any of us should be doing that at any given time, right? If there's a food that you're eating on a regular basis, why not just see what you feel like when that food is taken out, and you can do your own personal assessment. So that's a way that we can personalize and experience for ourselves, right? Not just what an expert says, but for ourselves. And that's what health counselors do, whereas a lot of other health professionals, they might suggest that, but they won't give you the opportunity to have the feedback and really get an understanding of how you're responding to the elimination.
Well, there's also the association. I think when many of us are experiencing bloating or headaches, or we're having different reactions in our body, we're not necessarily associating with something we're eating, right? So again, we just think that, well, I'm bloated and that's okay, or I've had some sort of reaction in my face, and we don't think of it as having to do with food, and we just go about our daily living and being, and we're not connecting it with anything. So it is good that if you are experiencing that, to, yes, play around with your food and start taking foods out and see if something changes or if you feel better.
Yeah, you mentioned bloating again, right? That's a symptom. I like that you mentioned symptoms, because oftentimes people will go to a doctor or take a medication to alleviate the symptoms, and then you notice that they're not getting alleviated, or you're still taking the prescription or taking the prescribed remedies, but then if you're not noticing a difference, then you have to readjust, course correct. And a lot of people don't do that, sadly.
That's right.
It's like they start taking a medication and then they believe that the medication is maybe preventing it from getting worse, or preventing something in the future. So it's almost like you hold on to that as like progress, when it's like, no, progress is moving forward and alleviating the actual symptoms. So if you're not alleviating the symptoms that you have, then another approach is out there for you to try.
That's right.
So for you, you mentioned that the symptoms weren't going away. Was there something, like a key moment that you noticed something changed in your behavior or your lifestyle, and then you noticed the symptoms alleviating?
So immediately for me, it was removing gluten, dairy, and soy for me.
Okay.
Gluten and dairy were huge for me. And then absolutely, I was sick most of my life from stress. And obviously my mother's death caused huge, tremendous amounts of stress for me. And work was causing me huge, tremendous.
And so I'm laughing because it's so interesting. As Amy's saying that, this is just the lens that I'm hearing it, right? You mentioned gluten, which is diet, which is physical. And then you mentioned an emotional tier, a cognitive tier, like all these, like a spiritual, like a parent dying, there's a spiritual component. So it's almost like these different layers, and it's almost like they have a combination effect on
That's
us, right?
So
it's like, so where do you go in? So sometimes people aren't able to change their job, or they're not fully ready to deal with the mourning of a loved one. But the eliminating gluten from the diet, that could be something that you could work.
Well,
like you
absolutely
could start there. Yeah.
That got rid of my brain fogginess. So that was immediate. I mean, I was feeling like I was drugged on a daily basis. So, I mean, that was what a horrible feeling. So to be able to get rid of that and be able to think more clearly, well, that was tremendous. And to get rid of that extreme fatigue, and let me tell you, I had used food for a long time to deal with my emotions. So what was I doing? I mean, I was running to the vending machine when I was stressed out at work. Those peanut M&Ms that I was having a love affair with on a daily basis, I mean, that was driving me absolutely mad and just only increasing my stress levels and increasing my fatigue and things like that. So, sugar addiction. That's a whole other thing. Addiction, right?
Yeah. Well, sugar really starts that up and down, like that roller coaster.
So it's
like, if we're already feeling life, like a stressful life, or emotional components going on in our lives where we're already having this kind of roller coaster ride effect, it's like, then you start eating foods that actually go along with that path.
That's right.
Rather than the reverse of saying, what can I do to try to level out my blood sugar levels, or level out the bloating, or like a lot of times the bloating foods, they're those comfort foods that kind of make you feel numb.
That's right.
So it's like this process of numbing out, and then this process of like amping up.
That's right.
So, and then it just creates this up and down effect that, and so we're on a different ride. We're putting our bodies physiologically on that ride when we're already on that ride, mm-hmm. either emotionally or with our thoughts. So it doesn't necessarily help us. Yes, it doesn't help us cope with those things any better. So it's seeing this bigger picture about where you can go in on those levels and say, which one can I just alter a little bit? And it doesn't, sometimes people can make a big change, right? If, like, say, stuff like with smoking cessation, some people can do it cold turkey. Mm-hmm. Right? That's why there's a term cold turkey. But other times, I think it is a more gradual process. Mm-hmm. It's seeing which one is the thing that you can actually be successful with eliminating, or a new food adding in, right?
That's
like,
right.
I love the concept of crowding out.
Yes.
Right? So when you discover that there's something like gluten that you want to take away, well, what do you replace? So it's called crowding out. Like, you add something new so that you no longer miss the thing that you're eliminating.
Right.
So can you speak on that? Did you do any of the crowding out?
Oh, please. Let me tell you what I did so much. So for me, I spent 4 days crowding out only to find myself in an Italian restaurant shoving a vat of pasta down my throat. It took me a while to figure it out. But for me, sugar being, I was such a sugar addict, right? And as many of you may know or not know, sugar is 8 times more addictive than cocaine, which is just so horrifying. But to me, I started adding in lots of sweet vegetables, because by 3 p.m., I could not break that sugar craving. And I was always eating that chocolate at 3 p.m. It would drive me mad. So lots of sweet vegetables, eating, you know, adding in the squash, the carrots, the beets, but also adding in that really healthy fat. So for me, adding in the avocado, making sure my blood sugar levels were stable. So making sure my plate was really balanced, and focusing on lots of those plant foods with a lot of, again, sweet vegetables and the healthy fats that helped me tremendously, and really having a nourishing, balanced breakfast. And that really helped curb out those 3 p.m. sugar cravings. For me, that was tremendous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even the foods that you're mentioning, because right, I think a lot of people, and it could work for them, and it depends on the season as well, you would think, oh, a replacement for sweets is fruit. But for some people's systems, that they respond similar, it's still a lot of sugar. So what Amy just mentioned, like, what I hear with that is like, oh, the sweet vegetables, they have the sweetness, but they're also grounding.
That's right.
They're much more grounding to our systems. So along with the fat, like the fat is an emulsifier. So it will let you feel, it weighs differently in your body. And that's a good thing. Like, many people have been told that fat is a bad thing. It depends on the source of the fat and what it can do within your body.
Right.
But fat as in and of itself is a macronutrient that we do need, and it really helps with our body functioning in a stabilized way.
And I still eat chocolate. I eat chocolate all the time. I just eat dark chocolate. Now, the chocolate I eat is gluten, dairy, and soy free, but I eat it almost every day, and it's filled with antioxidants. So I'm eating chocolate, I'm just eating a different type of chocolate that doesn't have all the chemicals in it. So it has a very different effect on my body.
Yes. And also, behavior-wise, I think there's a clear difference when you remember the peanut M&M days,
yes,
and the I eat dark chocolate nowadays.
Right.
It's like two different behaviors.
Yes.
It's like M&M's,
yes,
And then dark chocolate, you have a little nibble.
And you savor it. It's not rushing.
Yes.
The binging effect as the, now I savor it and I can take my little piece of dark chocolate. Exactly.
Yeah. And it shows you, once again, in our behavior, just kind of the association that it really has on our system. Like you mentioning sugar and the cocaine connection, or like the addictive aspect. And that's what some of these chocolate brands, or like not even to diss any brand, but that's what those things are made out of. And then therefore, they're just supplying us with that approach. Mm-hmm. Whereas, once again, cacao has these natural properties
that's
to it
right.
that could be helpful, or like a vegetable, right? How do you eat vegetables? You know, unless you're really, really hungry, you're not like pounding down the kale.
Right.
You know what I mean? You're eating, you're savory, you're eating it slowly, and it does have this more grounded effect. So that's something too, that you could just notice your own behavior as you're eating foods. Mm-hmm. But it's, this could all sounds like a great segue for the spring component,
right.
because in spring, we start speeding up a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. We start getting a little bit faster. And so what are some tips on how to make that transition from the slower winter vibe into moving into spring without overdoing it, right?
Right. So I think a lot of what has happened, some of what we've just been talking about, is we came out of a bit of a hibernation mode, right? And many of us may have experienced something that we call SAD, which is seasonal affect disorder, and it really, it's a very real thing. It's a bit of the winter blues or winter depression, where maybe you were experiencing some of the sitting on the couch, munching too much, finding yourself eating a bit of also what we call a SAD diet. That's the standard American diet, a lot more of the chemicalized processed foods, the sugars, the refined carbohydrates. So I think a nice way to now start to transition into this springtime is checking into some of those portions first and foremost. And an easy way to do that is first take a look at your plate. I love this plate tool as we're talking about. It's filling up 50% of your plate with colorful fruits and vegetables. It's such a great way to get back in check into the springtime, especially now as we're looking at more of those colorful spring vegetables, where in the wintertime we were eating lots of heavier foods like the stews and the root vegetables. Now take a look at like what's in your farmer's market or your local organic market and check into some of the brighter, colorful vegetables that are up there, and really focus your plate 50% of that colorful fruits and vegetables. You're 50% of the way there when we're looking to now reportion our plates. And then 25% of that lean protein, and then 25% of the plate as a whole grain. So again, to get back into healthy eating mode, that is a perfect plate tool. So whether you're eating out or at home, this is a great way to start reportioning your plate, and even getting your pantry and refrigerator back in order. Start going through your pantry and taking out those unhealthier options and cutting up those fresh, colorful fruits and vegetables. So when you open up your refrigerator, you start grabbing the healthier options as well. Because when we do open up our refrigerators or our pantries, we tend to just grab whatever is in front of us. So if you have pretzels and chips, you know, those are going to be the things you grab. So if you have really gorgeous fruits and vegetables, that will be what you, that's going to be what you grab first. So those are some great suggestions to start making some changes.
Yeah, and that's great, the visual, right?
Yeah.
Especially, I just think of the city, and it's like, a lot of people are like, oh, I can't eat out, I can't eat out. Actually, we have a lot of places where you can eat healthy, and oftentimes they do give you a portion like that. So mm-hmm. they're setting the portion for you. So it's like, yeah, the challenge with eating out, because we're out more in the spring, the challenge with eating out can be that, like, oh, I want to make sure that I eat healthy options. But portion-wise, there's a good bit of control, especially when you're coming out of that hibernation mode of winter, where you have your pantries right there. You have too much easy access to whatever foods, especially if they're packaged foods that you or you open. Oh, it's already opened. I opened it up. I might as well go in for a second helping. So we kind of lose sense of the portion control. So yeah, I love the visual, and not just the visual of the size, but like you said, the visual of the color. And when we're talking about color, we're not talking about artificial coloring, like these blues and purples that
not
make
Skittles.
Like, yes. No, the natural coloring of fruits and vegetables. And that's another thing to just say, oh, I haven't had any variety of color today my diet. So that's another cue that you can give yourself. And once again, making that shift into spring, it does get more colorful. We are outside more. There's more sunlight. So there are other ways to trigger that in our lifestyle. And then those things can be reminders of how we can transfer that into our diet and our plate.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think also a great reminder is if you're eating out, it's not, people say, oh, it's so challenging to eat out. You know, be a snob when you eat out. Ask for exactly what you want. So have the bread basket removed when you arrive at the table. You can ask for your meal, ask your waiter or waitress to just package half of it immediately so you can take half of that home because portions are so large, or ask for two appetizers instead of an entree. There's really easy ways to eat smaller portions as well when you're eating out, or skip the starch at dinner. Ask for more vegetables. That's a great way to know that you're getting more plants into your diet, which is really fantastic because most of us just do not eat enough fruits and vegetables into our diet. That's just a given.
Yeah. So. And it's only a benefit from adding more of that. So that's a great, once again, the term crowding out, right? So if you're focusing on eliminating one type of food, an easy food to add in is any vegetable.
Absolutely.
And it really helps us because it's not just a physiological thing. It's also a cognitive thing that we don't want to focus too much on the thing that we're eliminating.
That's right.
We want awareness and mindfulness of it, of course. But to then refocus our thoughts toward the thing that we're going to add in.
Mm-hmm.
And whether that be doubling up on the vegetable you love or trying a new vegetable in addition to the ones that you already like. So that's a good way. We have a question here, so I want to see.
Can't see that.
I know. It's what is your approach when a new client comes to you?
What is the approach when a new client comes to me? Well, first of all, when a new client comes to me, I like to do a really extensive discovery session. So I want to find out as much about that client as possible because each client is so specific and individualized, and my programs are very specific and individualized. So I'm really wanting to find out how I can best serve that individual. So again, I do a 90 minute intake. And I'm finding out about their habits from lifestyle to food to medications, supplements. It's very extensive, and I ask an overload of questions because what I recognized in my life is no one ever asked me questions to find out why I was sick. So if somebody comes to me, I know keywords really are weight loss. So people do come to me and they're like, well, I want to lose weight. But by the time I'm done, I'm finding out what's the reasons why they are eating too much. So is it the job? Is it a stressful job? Is it an unhealthy relationship? Is there something else that's happening behind that? Because we need to get to the whys of someone's behaviors, and then I can create a plan with both lifestyle and food choices that identifies their triggers.
Yeah, I love this type of approach, and I think that's pretty much where we're going in the health field, definitely the holistic health field, but even Western medicine is slowly getting more of this approach, more of this individualized, right? It used to be more, who is the expert, right? They did all these studies, they know this information, and even a lot of what we've discussed here, there's a broader picture, right? Generalizations that we can a framework that we can use, all right? Like just seasonal affect disorder, like things that already exist and are understood or can explain someone's condition, but how that condition plays out for them is always going to be different. And you won't know how those things play out for them unless you ask the question.
Of course.
So by having that generalized knowledge, or a lot of any dietary theory is generalized knowledge. Mm-hmm. Anybody now can go onto a computer and find more information about that diet. But how that diet is going to work for that person, or right, you might have a client that sits across from you and says, I've been doing this diet, and or like my friend's doing this diet, or
right.
someone else is doing this diet, and this is the result that they're getting.
Right.
So it's reminding them through asking questions and saying, well, what is your lifestyle like? What is your job like?
Right.
How are you handling stress?
Right.
Because right, how someone's handling stress or the amount of stress somebody has will compound whatever other thing that you're doing. So asking somebody these questions and having them elaborate on these different aspects of their lives gives you the opening for where to kind of direct them.
And what's very true is most people are not connecting their actions with their behaviors and how they're feeling. So somebody came to me and he had no idea that he was going home and binging on a pint of ice cream every evening because he was completely lonely and disconnected in his marriage. So by the time we got done talking, I mean, yes, did he need to lose weight? Absolutely, he needed to lose weight, but a diet wasn't going to fix that for this gentleman because he needed to connect with his partner and work on the relationship. So that's what we discovered in his session. And we had to start there first. So I hope that makes sense.
No, that does. And that's just one example of many.
Of many.
And even when you say that, I'm like, I'm sure there's a lot of us that have
Correct.
Done the whole ice cream pint thing. And it's like, after a while, it almost becomes like you're aware of it, but it's not full on mindfulness, right? Or you don't realize, one, that it's a behavior and that there's an emotional underpinning mm-hmm. to that behavior. So with certain clients, right, depending on how they talk about that experience, like if I were to talk to you about that experience, I would know. I'd be like, that's my comfort food, and I go home and I need that.
Right.
So then that's a different place to start with and be like, oh, okay, he's already aware of it. What can, maybe we have room to play with,
right.
what can replace that?
Right.
Whereas somebody else who isn't even seeing that connection between the behavior or what the underlying cause of the behavior is, then there may be a different approach.
And similarly to me, when I was growing up and from losing my mother, I came home every day and I stopped cutting pieces of things. So I would sit down and eat an entire Mrs. Smith's cherry pie. That was my thing. But I had no idea that I was eating the pie because I was so depressed over my mother's death. I didn't make any of the connections. So that is why I tap in so deeply to what's going on with people and ask them so many questions, because I have to identify what's happening so I can help them on a much deeper level.
Yeah, and that's once again a great visual, right? There's something deliberate, like a physical deliberate behavior, such as taking out a knife and cutting out a portion.
Right.
That it, because the emotion is so strong, or because something happened in someone's life to change that, you now you can go back and talk to somebody and kind of dissect it and say, oh, what was the actual behavior that could change? Because then you can add in that new behavior, right? What can you do physically, tactually, to add a new step of behavior into like your portion control again?
Right.
And while you're doing that physical thing, then you can also talk to the person about the emotional underpinning,
right.
and then start clearing that up. Yeah, it's pretty fascinating.
Right.
And it's amazing to me too, because I think a lot of people do that like with their best friend, like their closest friends, and they'll talk about that, but they don't, there's not a strategy there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's something that gets overlooked with health counselors and health coaches, right? We're not just there to disseminate information. Actually, right, that's gotten a lot easier for us in the past decade of us doing this, that it's like, wow, we know the resources to send people for the information. It's the strategy, it's the approach, it's in getting individualized with the person, and then right, you discuss with your client the strategy.
Right.
So can you speak on that? Do you find that they're open to new strategies, or what your technique might be in having them be accepting of new strategies?
Oh, absolutely. I think when by the time someone has come to me, they're at a place where, and they want that help. They want that new strategy because they want the change. And when I talk to somebody on the phone, I say, you know, if somebody is a bit indifferent and I sense that, I say, look, you're wise, because if someone has opened up to me and said, look, I've worked with other nutritionists, this hasn't worked, why are you going to be different? I say, well, you first have to know that you're wise or strong enough to want to change, because I can't make anybody change, right? It's I can show you the way, but you're going to do the work. So if your whys aren't strong enough, then you're not ready to come to me.
Yeah.
So when that person has come to me, I know that they are ready to make the change. And that's why they have success. So when we talk about what we're going to do, when they make an agreement with me, I mean, I'm not telling anybody what to do.
Yeah, even when you said that,
right?
When you said the whys, like the why is their own personal mission
exactly.
statement.
Exactly.
Right? So you need to attach to that bigger mission statement, right? There's other phrases for it, but that's what I call
right.
it. So yeah, once they have that, then and you can even pull that out of them through questioning, and then they can articulate that to you.
Correct.
And then not only do you see the drive, but that's going to be the anchor in a way to continue the motivation
that's
as
right.
you move forward.
And believe me, I can make a suggestion to someone and they'll say, well, Amy, I'm not going to do that. Fine, then here's something else. Will this work for you? So it's something we talk about together. Again, I'm here to help them meet their goals, and that is a commitment I make to someone. So, but they're fully on board once they have come in to see me. So, but I go to all ends for I love my clients, so I feel so incredibly fortunate to be able to work with each and every one of them.
Yeah. No, and it also ties into, right, people either do things out of inspiration or desperation. And oftentimes they can come in fully inspired from, like, something that they read or like, a video that they've seen, or, right, they just went to a conference and they're
right.
just like, wow, there's this great new approach. But I think there's so many other aspects of culture that have really just suppressed people from taking advantage of these other approaches.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not until the pre-existing model of take this pill, take this pill, take this pill, really just gets them to this place of, like, my symptoms aren't going away, and now I have 5 prescriptions.
That's right.
So that's a form of, right, just hitting a low and saying, all right, now I need that. So oftentimes, right, those are the types of people that come our way.
Absolutely.
It's just like, I've tried this, I've tried that, I've tried that. And that's another thing too, of why you need to have these discussions with people, because it's almost like they kind of have to shed that. You know, like, yeah, tell me your story quickly, like, right, like this discovery session, but we're gonna move on from here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't need to know, like, every time this is the backstory. Like, we wanna know some of that, because then that will help pave or shape how the road is paved moving forward. But there are other approaches out there, and to have a professional sitting across from you in which you can have those discussions, it's pretty powerful.
Yes.
But like you said, the person has to show up. They
right.
have to have their core reason as to why they want to do that, and usually it is change, right? Whether it's changing their behavior to lead a healthier life, or to make some changes so that previous symptoms are no longer there, or conditions that they have that, you know, they might have thought were, like, for the rest of their lives.
Mm-hmm.
But then, right, then they do see a documentary, or they do meet a friend that eliminated that condition in their life. So then you say, hey, oh, I can do that too. But you can't do that alone. You need support. And that's support in your own community and your own family, but then the one-to-one support that you can get from working
right.
with a professional.
Which I think is so, so essential.
Mm-hmm.
We get a different kind of support from someone on the outside that we're going to get from our best friend or husband, wife, or someone like that. I mean, it's different.
Yeah. And that's why you created the wellness map.
And that is why I created the wellness map. Absolutely.
Excellent. Yeah.
Absolutely.
And so do you find your clients like that you hold them accountable? Like you said with the suggestions, I think I agree too. Suggestions and recommendations are a two-way street. I like to check in with them, but I'm not like, you didn't do that
Never.
Specific. It's a discussion.
Right. It's
but accountability, right? Accountability to me is it's still acknowledging it. And yes, we can make this correction, but accountability is saying, well, last session you said
That's
that you want
is.
To change this. So what can we do?
That's right. And it's more about, you know, what was going on for you this week, because it's, no one wants to feel punished or wronged or judged, and it's never about that. So I don't think anybody comes to me. I had one guy say, this has been the most humbling experience of my life, but he is continuing to make such tremendous progress, and I love to see it. I love to see the journey, but it's never about, I didn't do this. It's about, okay, well, what happened for you this week? Like, is there something that held you back? It's something, what was going on for you? And then we talk about that, because what's happening in the moment? Because this is about real life. We're living in reality. This isn't fantasy world, and things come up for all of us. And maybe something at work happened. Maybe something at home happened. And maybe that drove someone to have that extra drink or eat that cupcake or whatever it was. And then we talk about that, and we say, okay, so when that happens, let's talk about the tools to deal with that the next time.
Yeah.
So that's what it's all about. It's about empowering somebody and giving them the tools they need to manage this for life. This is not about diets.
Yeah.
We're not on a diet here.
It's about life and
that's
lifestyle.
Right.
And yeah, and it's reacting and responding to things, but then also having that extra step, like you said, the discussion, so that we can take some of that response and reactiveness and then become proactive.
Exactly.
Right, it reshapes and then continue to move forward. And I love the word empowered, which you said. And I think that's a good note to end on, because we've been talking for a while
awesome.
Here. But yes, to continue to be empowered and to continue to feel supported. I think that's another key component of this type of approach moving forward. A lot of people have had experiences where they've just been prescribed something or just try something, and then they don't have the network of support. So that is out there, and there are many professionals that can provide that for people. So, and Amy is one of them. I will put Amy's information connected to this video, which we will have for people to continue to view in the future. And you can go to Amy's website, which is
thewellnessmap.org. So again, that's thewellnessmap.org.
Excellent. So thank you so much, Amy. This was so much fun.
Yeah, no,
and,
thank you.
And we'll continue to talk.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Bye-bye.